And it was the force of the individual word. If you look at on paper at, oh, what a beautiful morning, oh, what a beautiful day, it doesn't look like much. But he understood that what happens when music is applied to words is that the words explode, that they have their own rainbows, they have their own magic, not on the printed page, not on the page. Some lyrics read well, conversational lyrics. I write a lot of conversational lyrics. They read well. Oscars do not read very well because they need music, and it's because of the super simplicity of the language. And it is precisely that that gives them such force. If you listen to What's the Use of Wondering from Carousel, you'll see what I mean.
He also stressed the importance of creating character in the songs, dealing with character, which is something that you've done exceptionally well.
Well, he was a playwright. He was a playwright. He started as a playwright even before he became a songwriter. And he understood that songs, at least in his versions, were one-act plays. They have a beginning, a middle, and an end. Oscar's songs are little plays. He started that as early as Showboat. And that's truly how he revolutionized musical comedy, is utilizing operetta principles and pasting them onto American musical comedy. And they are plays, those songs.
I think he blasted it open with the bench scene in Carousel. It was brand new. It was as if it had arrived from another planet.
That's probably the single most important moment in the development of contemporary musicals.
He also, as I recall, outlined for you a curriculum as you were young. Yeah. And he told you he wanted you to write four things. It was sort of like a wonderful fairy tale, a fairy godmother who doesn't give you four wishes, but makes four demands of you. What were they?
He said, he outlined a course for me after this extraordinary afternoon when I was 15. He said, over the next few years, he said, first take a play that you like and that you think is good and musicalize it. In musicalizing it, you'll get to know it very well and get to analyze it. So then take a play that you think is good but flawed, that you think could be improved, and musicalize that. And he said, then take a non-play, something that somebody else has written, can be a novel, short story, but not a play, not something that has been structured dramatically for the stage, and musicalize that. And then he said, then try an original. And over the next 5 years, it took me till the year after I got out of college, as a matter of fact, I did just that. The first one I did, pardon me, was a play by George Kaufman and Mark Connolly called Beggar on Horseback, which lends itself very well to musicalization because it's essentially a long fantasy. And the second one, which I couldn't get permission for, was a play by Maxwell Anderson that won the Pulitzer Prize called High Tor, which I liked but which I thought was sort of clumsy. And so I did that. And then I did a series of short stories called Mary Poppins. And I couldn't solve that because I'd never finished it because I couldn't figure out how to take a series of disparate short stories, even though the characters existed through them, and make an evening, make a structure, make an arc. And then I wrote an original after that.
The original one was?
It was called Climb High, and there was a motto on the stone steps that Williams said, climb high, climb far, your aim the sky, your goal the star. And I thought, gee, that's very Hammerstein-ish.
When you sent it to him, the first act was...
Oh, God, how do you know all these things?
I studied. I've also known him an awfully long time.
I sent him the first act. I sent him the whole thing. The first act was 99 pages long. Now, the entire script of South Pacific, which lasted almost 3 hours on the stage, was 92. But my first act was 99. He sent it back, just circled 99, just put, wow.
It's a step up from the worst musical I ever read, I must say. The Williams, you studied, your major was in composition and piano.
Oh, music, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Music. And your mentor there was Robert Barrow.
Mm-hmm. Robert Barrow, I went to college expecting to major in English. I was a mathematician by nature and still am. And I just knew I didn't want to be a mathematician, so I decided not to take any mathematics courses. And being a liberal arts college, the natural neutral major is English. And I took an elective my first year, which was music. which was generally known as a gut course up there. I'd always thought that, of course, music is about sitting in your penthouse or your studio, and this lady comes, you know, and twitters around your head and sits on your shoulders and goes, da-da-da-dum, da-da-da, something like that. I believed in the muse, the midnight muse. And Robert Barrow was talking about leading tones and diatonic scales, and I fell in love. He took all the mystery out of music and taught craft. And within a year, I was majoring in music. And he changed my life, very importantly, by making me aware that art is craft, not inspiration.
Yeah. I'm not surprised to hear that you're a good mathematician. I didn't know that. I've never known a musician who wasn't a good mathematician. I think that both...
They go together.
They go together. That's
and medicine. Saying. Medicine, mathematics, and music. Yeah. Three M's.
And now that I know, I'm surprised you never solved Fermat's last theorem.
That would start... Wouldn't that have been nice?
It's right up your street. When Steve graduated from Williams, he received the Hutchinson Prize for Music, which was a fellowship, and he spent the money on lessons here in New York City with another great influence on him, Milton Babbitt.
I don't know how many of you know who Milton Babbitt is, but he is the avant-gardist. And he is a rigorous intellectual when it comes to music, and he also happens to be a frustrated songwriter. So when I first met him, he was writing a musical for Mary Martin while he was also teaching at Princeton and working up at Columbia at the synthesizer. And we would spend, I met with him once a week for about 4 hours. And we'd spend the first hour analyzing his favorite, De Silva, Brown, and Henderson, but sometimes called Porter, Kern. I can still analyze All the Things You Are, according to Babbitt, which in fact I did at Oxford to show off to the students. And then we would analyze Beethoven and Mozart. I asked him if he would teach me atonal music. He said, there's no point until you've exhausted tonal resources for yourself. And he said, you haven't. I said, no, I haven't, and I never want to. I like tonal music, and so I never did study atonal music. But he taught tonally, and he taught it as rigorously as Barrow did. It was a similar approach.
I'd like to talk just one moment now about writing lyrics, qua lyrics. Dorothy Hammerstein, or so the story goes, the way I've heard it, you can tell me whether it's true or not. You want to tell it?
No, you tell it
better.
She did say.
She was another of Steve's mentors. She was a great friend to him. Dorothy Hammerstein was a very elegant and brilliant woman. Once heard somebody say at a party, was it the wife of Jerome Kern or Kern himself?
I don't know.
The wife of Jerome Kern, and said, my goodness, your husband, said the woman, wrote Old Man River. And Dorothy Hammerstein intervened and said, no, he didn't. He wrote dum, dum, da, dum. My husband wrote Old Man River. Now, that illustrates, I think, quite concisely the difference between writing words and music. And you have said, maybe so or not, you tell me if it is, you've said, I've always thought of lyric writing as a craft rather than art, largely a matter of sweat and time. God knows it takes time. It's the slowest craft in the world. But you have compared it, you said that music is more challenging, more interesting, and more rewarding. Do you feel that way still?
Oh, sure, because music's abstract, and, you know, it's fun, and it lives in you. Language is terrific, but the English language, which is, you know, a great language, is a difficult tool to work with, you know. I was talking the other night about the unfortunate coincidence that two of the hardest words in the language to rhyme are life and love, of all words, you know? Yeah. If you're an Italian, easy, but not in English. English are hard, and making lyrics feel natural, sit on music in such a way that you don't feel the effort of the author, and so they shine and bubble and rise and fall, is very, 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 very hard to do. And whereas you can sit at the piano and just do that and feel you're making art.
That's what you think.
You feel, I said, you're making art.
The rhymes are love, shove, above, dove, glove, and of. That's all we've got.
That's about it.
Huh?
That's about it, and they're not easy to use.
And then you can make an apocryphatic rhyme out of discover or something like that. But even Steve has ended a sentence with a preposition, of, in order to get to love in live, laugh, love. Then in the next stanza, he said to hell with that, and it became love, laugh, live,
right.
Or something. So he could get away from that love rhyme. French has
live isn't easy either.
No.
You got give, and you're in a lot of trouble.
One makes these lists in one's head. The French language has a dozen sounds in it. The English language has 42. And there are 400 ways of writing those 42 sounds. Orthographically, the English language is very bitchy. The French language only has 12 sounds. That's why Molière is able to write those Alexandrines, couplet after couplet, without ever straining himself or
But it's, also about, it's also about open vowel sounds. The Italians
Absolutely.
Have it all over us because everything is ah. And it's terrific. I mean, try to sing me on a high note, and me is a very useful word. But, you know,
or him.
Yes, exactly. Short I's are terrible. And the singers, you know, as I'm sure Jim and Liz will tell you, their throats close up.
The company was, it really was revolutionary. Was it a plotless show?
Yeah, it was a plotless show. What had happened was George Firth had written some one-act plays. He was an actor, and he was in therapy, and his therapist said, it might be good for you to do some writing. So he wrote a series of one-act plays, playlets, really. They weren't even one-act plays. And he sent them to me and said, I don't know what to do with these. And I said, let me send them to Hal Prince, because he's very shrewd about this sort of thing. Maybe he can give you some advice. And Hal said, why don't we do a musical out of them? And of course, it seemed impossible because it were these disparate plays. And so that made it intriguing. So George came east. He lived on the coast at that point. And we spent two or three weeks talking about how to make this into a form. And gradually, the form of those plays, the idea that there's two people and a third person, two people and a third person, suddenly, you know, the light bulb started to glow a little bit. And we realized that what the show should be about is about the third person. So we invented the character of Bobby, the outsider in the five different marriages. And we realized that there would be no plot, but in our head what it is a man comes home on his 35th birthday and realizes that all his friends are married, that he is an outsider, and he has a kind of combination breakdown and epiphany, and the show really takes place in 1 second. So the idea of the show is that it's his birthday, and there are five times during the evening that the birthday party, which is seemingly a surprise party, but it's mysterious, it's surreal. His friends are there, but they're not there. They're fragments of his consciousness. And that's what made it an unusual show. It had no plot. It took place in a single moment of time, but at the same time was not a review, because it had the same characters. It was indeed five one-act plays tied together with musical moments in between. Also, none of the songs occurred coming out of scenes. Each of the songs was a comment or was the entire scene itself. And all the songs, with the exception of one, dealt with marriage or aspects of marriage, of relationships, a word I don't much like, but I did in those days. And so it became this kind of Twilight Zone review. And that whole area between review and book is something I've always been interested in, and showed up in Follies, it showed up in Assassins, and that's what was, to use Jimmy's word, revolutionary.
Bobby beds what used to be called a stewardess, is now called an attendant, airline attendant, a beautiful young woman, and this is their waking up. This is Steve writing the most extraordinary dialogue as a song.
Why? To go to
stay.
I have to
fly.
Look, you're a very special girl, not just overnight. No, you're a very special girl, and not because you're bright. Not just because you're bright. You're just a very special girl, June.
April. Thank you.
What you thinking?
Barcelona.
Oh.
Flight 18.
Stay a minute.
I would like to.
So.
Don't be
stay a minute.
No, I can't.
Yes, you can.
No, I can't.
Where are you going?
Barcelona.
So you said.
And Madrid.
Bon voyage.
On a Boeing.
Good night.
You're angry.
No.
I've got to.
Right.
Report to.
Go.
That's not to say that if I had my.
Does anybody here have any idea how hard it is to write like that? There aren't very many words in that song. How long did it take you to write it?
I'm sorry to disappoint you, James. 2 days.
Son of a bitch. Company, despite its radical composition, won the Drama Critics Award for the Best Musical and 6 Tonys, including Best Musical and Best Score. Not content, Steve went on to write a musical called Follies. Today, the concept musical is commonplace. The British seem to have inherited it from us, and some people think they invented it. Follies was certainly a concept musical.
Jim Goldman and I went to Jim and asked him if he had any ideas for musicals, and he'd always wanted to do one, wanted to write a play, actually, about reunions. And he recently picked up a newspaper clipping about the Ziegfeld Girls annual reunion, and he thought that might make a basis for it. We started out, when we started writing, it took a period of 4 years to write Follies, not steadily. Every time we would do a draft, the atmosphere for the first few minutes would be fine. And then as soon as the plot came in, it would start to get a little ratchety. So we decided to delay the plot maybe for 15 minutes. So we got 15 minutes, and then we start to get ratchet, then we delayed it for 25. Finally, it struck us that maybe there shouldn't be any plot at all, and that it should all be atmosphere, and that is in fact what it turned out to be. And what it really is it's about the loss of innocence, not only among the characters, but the loss of innocence in America, really, between the wars, which the Follies, I think, represented. So it became this mood piece. Was Chekhovian, but it also had to do with time. And Hal gave it a surreal spin in the staging, Hal and Michael Bennett, that increased the whole kind of mysterioso quality of it, which is the best thing about it.
Here is another extraordinary example of Steve playing with words and music. Here's a great big sort of valse triste. Steve is brilliant with 3/4, and this is just a woman describing to her husband what's gonna happen now. Liz Callaway with Could I Leave You?
Leave you, how could I leave you? wipe tears away when your eyes are dry. Sweetheart, lover, could I recover? Give up the joys I have known. Not to fetch your pills again every day at 5. Not to give those dinners for 10 elderly men from the UN. How could I survive? Could I leave you and your shelves of the world's best books and the evenings of martyred looks, cryptic sighs, sullen glares from those injured eyes, leave the quips with a sting, jokes with a sneer, passionless lovemaking once a year, leave the lies ill-concealed and the wounds never healed and the game's not worth winning and wait, I'm just beginning. What? Leave you? Leave you? How could I leave you? What would I do on my own? Putting thoughts of you aside in the south of France, would I think of suicide? Darling, shall we dance? Could I live through the pain on a terrace in Spain? Would it pass? It would pass. Could I bury my rage with a boy half your age in the grass? Bet your ass. But I've done that already. Or didn't you know, love? Tell me, how could I leave when I left long ago? Love, could I leave you? No, the point is, could you leave me? Well, I guess you could leave me the house, leave me the flat, leave me the Brocs and Chagalls and all. You could leave me the stocks for sentiment's sake and 90% of the money you make and the rugs and the cooks. Darling, you keep the drugs. Angel, you keep the books. Honey, I'll take the grand sugar. You keep the spinet and all of our friends and just wait a goddamn minute. Oh, leave you, leave you. How could I leave you? Sweetheart, I have to confess. Could I leave you? Yes. Will I leave you? Will I leave you? Yes.
When you start writing, Steve, since you're both the composer and the lyricist, we all heard the old joke, which comes first, the music or the lyrics, the check, etc. But attributed to Richard Rodgers. But the what do you start with, since you write both?
Two basic things, some kind of accompaniment figure and or some kind of refrain line or central idea for a lyric. The two kinds of glue for a song, as far as I'm concerned. One is the accompaniment, and the other is some kind of central idea, whether it's a refrain line actually repeated or not. But the thing is to keep them going together, so you don't get boxed in.
Steve has admitted, thank God, he took us all off the hook, that he uses a rhyming dictionary.
Sure.
And I think we use the same one. I use Clement Wood.
That's the only one. It's the only one. And for a very simple reason, all the words are listed vertically, so. If you're looking down, if you use one that's horizontal, your eye starts to skip, it gets tired, starts to skip over the words. But when they're listed that way, the problem with Clement Wood is it was published in like 1938, so there are very few modern words in it. But I've written a lot of words into it. It was out of print for years, and luckily I'd bought 6 of them, so I had them all over the place. But it's now in print again. And if anybody wants to write lyrics, that's the one to use.
The other thing that's essential. It's a thesaurus, not a dictionary, but a thesaurus, because you all often want to know what your choices are. And there I also have a favorite. It's an old book. My mind fell apart, literally fell apart, and I found another copy in the Strand. And
what?
It's by Norman Lewis.
I don't know it.
It's a thesaurus in dictionary form. It's simply wonderful.
No,
highly
I'd
recommend.
Like to see that.
Huh?
I'd like to see that.
Oh, it's much better. The way Roger arranged it mystifies me. You would like it.
But see, the Roger, what's interesting about that is it opens up your mind, because in doing the cross-reference, when you start going back and forth, you suddenly, you think of shadings of words and they lead to other words. The problem with the Roger is it's been in so many editions. The only one that I think it's really right is the 1943 edition, and it's very hard to find because, well, it's a very good reason. Very good reason.
It sounds
fussy, but, you know, you work with tools over a period of time, and they become important. Up until that edition, there weren't very many words. There were many meanings, but not very many words. After that, there were too many words and not enough cross-references.
When you are working, I have heard you say that you don't want to work at the piano, and that interests me a lot.
If you're too good a piano player, some composers are, I think the music becomes flavorless and glib. And if you're not a very good pianist, then you're limited to just your fingers fall into the same patterns. I force myself to write in different keys that I haven't written in for a while. Sharp keys are, I find it's true of most composers, sharp keys are the enemy and flat keys are the friends. Flat keys somehow are more welcoming. I force myself quite often to write in sharp keys just to get away from the patterns. I think it's very important to try to write away from the piano.
Sweeney Todd made another revolution. Sweeney Todd was operatic. Sweeney Todd used leitmotifs, as opera does. People had themes, and the themes assembled, disassembled, reassembled before our eyes.
Sweeney Todd not only has a lot of singing, it has a lot of underscoring, but that's why it's so infused with music, is to keep the audience in a state of suspense so that they never realize they're in a theater and can divorce themselves from the action, and that's the way when they get scared.
Bear in mind, because Steve writes from character and from story, that as this man, Sweeney, sings this song, he is shaving the neck of his arch enemy and preparing to cut it.
Pretty women, fascinating. Sipping coffee, dancing, pretty women are a wonder. Pretty women sitting in the window or standing on the stair, something in them cheers the air. Pretty women, silhouetted, stay within you, glancing, stay forever, breathing lightly. Pretty women, blowing out their candles or combing out their hair, even when pretty women at their mirrors, in their gardens, letter writing, flower picking, weather watching, how they make a man sing. Proof of heaven as you're living. Pretty women, yes, pretty women. Here's to pretty women, pretty women, pretty women, pretty women.
Sunday in the Park with George marked a new collaboration. Steve has been intensely loyal to his collaborators, and they to him. It was the long period of Hal Prince, and now we are in the Sondheim-James Lapine period, which has given us new miracles and a different sensibility. Lapine comes from photography and graphic design. He was avant-garde. He's a poet.
I'd seen a play that he wrote and directed called 12 Dreams, and I wanted to get together with him, and he wanted to get together with me, but a mutual friend, a producer, got us together, and we just started to talk, and we started talking about paintings, and he had used the Surratt in a piece he had done up at Yale, and he said, did you ever notice there are over 50 people in it and nobody looking at anybody else? We started to speculate why that would be true, And suddenly we realized it was like, and I said, it's like a stage set, you know, it's like a French farce, isn't it? You know, maybe those people aren't supposed to be seen with each other because, you know, they're cheating on each other. And we started to talk about it and how it might make a story. And then James said the crucial thing. He said, of course, the main character's missing. I said, who? He said, the painter. And as soon as he said that, we knew we had a show because it's about a man and his landscape and a man who controls, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
This musical won what it deserved, the Pulitzer Prize for drama. Liz will sing to you the opening number, Dot. I hate that name, by the way, Dot. That's too on the nose for you.
Except, you know, it's a very French name. There are movie actresses named Dot. Dot is, yes, not Dorothy. Dot is a very French name. Okay. Sorry.
But the only thing I hate in it, the rest I think is beyond description. It's so good. And he's painting her. She's in a bustle and she's fastened and she can't move, and he's irritated when she does move, as you'll hear. And this begins here, once again, listen to this opening number that tells you so much in so little time.
George, why do you always get to sit in the shade while I have to stand in the sun? George, hello, George. There is someone in this dress. A trickle of sweat. The back of the head. He always does this. Now the foot is dead. Sunday in the park with George. One more. The collar is damp. Beginning to pinch. The bustle slipping. I won't budge one inch. Who was at the zoo, George? Who was at the zoo? The monkeys and who, George? The monkeys and who?
Don't move, please.
Artists are bizarre. Fixed, cold. That's you, George, you're bizarre. Fixed, cold. I like that in a man. Fixed, cold. God, it's hot out here. Well, there are worse things than staring at the water on a Sunday. There are worse things than staring at the water as you're posing for a picture being painted by your lover in the middle of the summer on an island in the river on a Sunday. Petticoat's wet, which adds to the weight. The sun is blinding. All right, concentrate.
Eyes open, please.
Sunday in the park with George.
Look out at the water, not at me.
Sunday in the park with George. Concentrate, concentrate. Well, if you want bread and respect and attention, not to say connection, modeling's no profession. If you want instead, when you're dead, some more public and more permanent expression of affection, you want a painter, poet, sculptor, preferably marble, granite, bronze, durable, something nice with swans that's durable forever. I love your size, George, but most, George, of all, but most of all, I love your painting. the tip of a stay, right under the tit. No, don't give in, just lift the arm a bit.
Don't lift the arm, please.
Sunday in the park with George.
The bustle high, please.
Not even a nod, as if I were trees. The ground could open, he would still say please. Never know with you, George. Who could know with you? The others I knew, George. Before we get through, I'll get to you too. God, I am so hot. Well, there are worse things than staring at the water on a Sunday. There are worse things than staring at the water as you're posing for a picture after sleeping on the ferry, after getting up at 7 to come over to an island in the middle of a river.
The mouth.
George.
We will end with a song from Sunday in the Park with George that sums up almost everything that's been said this evening. Young George, at the end of the musical, he is the grandson, is he? Great-grandson of Seurat. Seurat's mistress was pregnant, she came to America, had this child, and he had a child, and then this is the child of the child. Now he's gone back to the island of La Grangeate, looking for something, he doesn't know quite what, and this apparition appears to him. It's Dot, Bernadette Peters in the musical. And she speaks to him, and I believe she speaks to all of us.
I've nothing to say.
You have many things.
Well, nothing that's not been said.
Said by you.
I do not know where to go.
And nor did I.
I want to make things that count. Things that
I did what I had to do.
What am I to do?
Shaken, so what? The choice may have been mistaken, the choosing was not. You have to move on. Look at what you want, not at where you are, not at what you'll be. Look at all the things you've done for me. Opened up my arms. Taught me how to see, notice every tree,
understand the light,
concentrate on
now. I want to explore the light. I want to know how to get through to something new, something of my own.
You've done
something in the light,
and at what
something
you want,
in the sky,
not at where
in the grass,
you are,
up behind
what you'll
the tree.
Be. Look at all the things you gave to me.
Things I hadn't looked
Let
at till now.
Let me give to you
flower
something
on your
in
hat,
return.
And your smile.
I
and
would be so
the color of your hair. And the way you catch the light. And the care. Feeling.
Anything you do, let it come from you. Then it will be new. Give us more to see.
As you know, we end our evenings now with the famous questionnaire of Bernard Pivot from Apostrophe and Bouillon de Couture, and I would be remiss if I didn't play this game with the greatest game player alive. Steve,
yeah.
What is your favorite word?
My favorite word? Oh, gosh, there's so many. The first one that comes to mind is pioneer.
Yes. What, please, is your least favorite word?
Least favorite word? Least favorite. I like so many words. What don't I like? Let's see. Celery is a word I don't like.
What, please, is your favorite drug? It need not be a chemical.
Music.
The sound or noise you love the most?
I'm afraid it's music again, but that's cheating, I suppose.
The sound or noise, you can't cheat. The sound or noise you hate.
Oh, anything hitting glass.
What is your favorite curse word?
It's a great word. I was gonna say it's one of my favorites. It's a wonderful word.
Hammerstein told him to be simple. If you couldn't do what you're doing now, what job would you like most?
Teaching.
We have 59 students here at our master's degree program. What job would you like the least?
Elevator operator.
What plant, tree, or animal would you like to come back as if you could be reincarnated?
Plant, tree, or animal?
Uh-huh.
Standard poodle.
And finally, in French, there was Bernard Pivot says, "Si Dieu existe, if God exists," but this is America, so I'll say, "If heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive?"
Welcome. It's a nice game. I like that.
Now I've seen a look of disappointment on a few faces, and I sense that some people are saying, no, they can't possibly leave it out. So we won't.
Just when I'd see making my entrance again with my usual flair. Sure of my lines, no one is there. Was that a farce?
My fault, I fear.
Me as a merry-go-round.
Me as King Lear. Make way for the clowns.
Applause for the clowns.
They're finally here.
That's off, ladies and gentlemen, a genius, Stephen Sondheim.
In a new school classroom, the studio's MFA candidates are only too happy to grant Steve's wish to teach. Stephen, these are the 59 students in our master's degree program. They are writers, directors, and playwrights, and they're very, very good. They are the winnowing of more than 1,000. Who applied, and do we have a microphone for them if they want to ask a question?
Hi, my name is Lisa, and I'm an actor. My question is about musical theater and opera. As you look back over like the last 20 years or so, you can't help but notice musical theater and opera sort of inching a little bit closer to each other stylistically. I was wondering if you thought that that was because, I don't know, musical theater, as we tend to think of it in its old form, Rodgers and Hammerstein, meaning nothing bad. I mean, I grew up eating and drinking Rodgers and Hammerstein.
I'm not an opera fan. I don't like wall-to-wall music. And the so-called operatic musicals are not as sophisticated. You talked about Rodgers and Hammerstein being simple. No, it's the wall-to-wall musicals that are simple because they don't know how to write songs, so they write endless recitative. It's very hard to write a song and very easy to write that kind of piece. Very easy. The wall-to-wall, you know, they call them operas. They're not operas. There's no development of the music whatsoever in these pieces we're talking about, the shows. The best of popular music is song forms. You know, a story is told within a given song. I know a lot of popular music is about the performer, and a lot of it is about sound, per se, but there are still songs. Songwriting is what's hard. To tell a story through song is hard. To develop musical ideas is hard. To write wall-to-wall music is easy.
Hi, I'm Issa Davis. My question is, after having been in this divine ecstasy listening to all of your songs up there and watching you in ecstasy listening to your own songs, wondering what your musical influences are. Who are the, I mean, I hear the a sort of a Debussy.
Yeah, they're mostly classical. It's Ravel more than Debussy. But, you know, Ravel's responsible for virtually all popular music anyway. I mean, all those chords really started with him. My period is from Brahms through, I don't know, 1930, Stravinsky. I mean, when I say period, that's where I live. I like music before and I like music after, but that's down here. And Britain shows up a lot in the stuff I write. You know, Sunday in the Park with George is a Britain score, I think. And I'm very fond of English music. As far as American music goes, and I was brought up also, of course, on show tunes. So, you know, the so-called golden era, which is a phrase I don't like, but there it is, you know, Kern and Gershwin. So those are influences, too. But it's Ravel, Britain, Stravinsky, Kern, Gershwin, Arlen, a lot of Arlen.
This question gained more value for what you said about that you're more interested in acting than singing. Mm-hmm. In the process we're doing, we explore more the life on stage moment to moment. And it happened to me to read in a newspaper about there was an interview to Mr. Donovan, who happened to direct you at Sweeney. And in a certain moment of the production, it seems that you asked him, so when are you going to, when do you stage to freeze the production? And is this a very consolidated process, and does it happen more in musical where maybe the music element is more?
That's exactly what it was. He slightly misquoted me on that, but the point was that because musicals are presentational plays as opposed to plays, the whole idea of a musical is out front. Numbers go out front, no matter how intense, they go out front. Whereas a play goes like this. Therefore, the performer has to make a contact with the audience, and as writers out front, I have to see that contact being made before I start to change things. Then you can look at the play and say, aha, is it my fault? Shall I rewrite, or shall I tell you to perform the song differently? Remember, it's all because it's presentational. That's what makes musicals entirely different and makes them very difficult to work with if you don't pay attention to that. You can make terrible errors. You can throw out a lot of the baby with the bathwater if you're not careful. You can also upset a performer because they are not just acting, they are performing. Notice there's a big distinction there. If you're an actor, you can just play the scene. If you're a performer, you have to make the number land if that's what's required. And to make it land doesn't just mean to sing loudly. It means everything from the acting to the voice to the presentation. Also the lights and everything. Remember when you start singing a musical number, the lights go down. You may not notice in the theater, but they do. They always do. That doesn't happen in a scene. So everything is conspired to make it false. And your job is to make it true and at the same time please the audience.
It's late. It's time to go home. Join me in thanking Steve.
It is right over there. Come along.
Do not push me.
I am not pushing. I am helping.
You are pushing? And I do not need any help.
Yes, madame.
And it is not our tree.
Yes, madame.
I do not envy the nurse.
She can read.
They were talking about you at La Coupole.
Oh.
Saying strange things.
They have so little to speak of, they must speak of me.
Were you at the zoo, George? Drawing the monkey cage?
Not the monkey cage.
They said they saw you.
The monkey's dot, not the cage.
This is true. Why draw monkeys?
Nurse, what is that?
What, madame?
That. Off. In the distance. They are making way for the exposition.
What exposition?
The international exposition. They are going to build a tower.
Another exposition?
They say it is going to be the tallest structure in the world.
Oh, foreigners. I am sick of foreigners.
More boats. More trees.
George. Is it you always get to sit in the shade while I have to stand in the sun? George? Hello, George? There is someone in this dress. Trickle of sweat. The back of the head. He always does this. Now the foot is dead. Sunday in the park with George. One more. The collar is damp. He pinch. The bus goes flipping. I won't budge one inch. Who was at the zoo, George? Who was at the zoo? The monkeys and who, George? The monkeys and the zoo.
Don't move, please.
Artists are bizarre, thick, cold. That's you, George, you're bizarre, thick, cold. I like that in a man, thick, cold. God, it's hot out here. Well, there are worse things than staring at the water on a Sunday. There are worse things than staring at the water as you're posing for a picture being painted by your lover in the middle of the summer. Coat's wet, which adds to the weight. The sun is blinding. All right, concentrate.
Eyes open, please.
Sunday in the park with George.
Look out at the water, not at me.
Sunday in the park with George. Concentrate, concentrate. And attention, not to say connection. Modeling's no profession. If you want instead, when you're dead, some more public and more permanent expression of affection. You want a painter, poet, sculptor, preferably marble, granite, bronze, durable. Something nice with long, that's durable forever. Stay right under the tits.